depends on what. Good shit, this one. Okay. Okay. Praise Him. Praise the Father. We just give you praise and glory. We thank you, God, for all of your wonderful mercies. Your mercies are new every morning. We thank you, God, that you are working your will and the due of your good pleasure in us. Father, we thank you for every good and every perfect gift, all from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Lord, you don't change. You're consistent. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. For that reason, we can trust fully in you, committing our way unto you, trusting also in you, and you will bring, yes, our way to pass. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that you daily loaded us with benefits. You delighted in mercy. Lord, we thank you that you are a sun and a shield. You give grace and glory. No good thing will you withhold from them that walk uprightly before you. Father, you delighted in mercy. Oh, you give strength to the faint, to them that have no might. You increases their strength, for they that wait upon you shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Father, we thank you today. Oh, God, for you are full of compassion. You are gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. We thank you, Lord. Oh, God, that you delighted in the prosperity of your servants. Oh, yes, Lord, it's your will for us to have a favorable and expectant end. Hallelujah. We thank you tonight, Jesus. Hey, yeah, for your good and your mercy and do it forever. Oh, God, your mercy, yes, you didn't do it forever. Oh, God, we thank you that your eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth. You are looking for those hearts that's open, those hearts that's perfect, those hearts of glory that are seeking you and desiring more of you. Lord, we thank you tonight. Glory. Yes. We thank you tonight, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God, for your gracious favors. Oh, you inclined to show favors. Oh, God, you want to bless us more than we want need to be blessed. Yes. Lord, you delighted in blessing. Yes. Lord, we thank you that you supplied all of our need according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. It's your good pleasure, God, to give us the kingdom. Good pleasure to give us the kingdom. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. Oh, we thank you tonight, Lord, that you didn't spare your own son. You delivered him up for us all. How shall we not with him? Yes, freely be given all things. Yes, all things have been given to us in the spirit realm, things that pertain unto life. Every good and every perfect gift cometh from you. Our sufficiency is of you. We can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Oh, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Lord, we thank you for beginning the good work within us. You who have begun the good work shall continue to perform it until Jesus comes. Lord, we delight in you tonight. Hey, we delight in you. We delight in you. We've been accepted in your beloved. Yes, of your fullness we have received. Hey, Lord, we thank you, Lord. Hey, we thank you, Lord. that grace and peace is multiplied to us. Hey, Lord, you ever liveth. You ever liveth to make intercession for us. You that faithful and compassionate, high praise at the right hand of God, Lord, inviting us continuously to come before your presence, to come before your presence, come before the throne. Yes, to ask for mercy, to ask for help, whatever is needed, Lord. Lord, we thank you today that you ever liveth. Hallelujah. We thank you today, Lord. We thank you today. We give you praise and the glory. We thank you, God, for all that you're doing. Yes, 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 yes. Hallelujah. We give you the honor tonight. You're worthy to receive the glory. Oh, God, you bought us with a great price. Yes, you shed your blood, you commended your love toward us when we were dead in sin, trespasses and sin. You commended your love toward us when we were yet without strength. In due time you died, lifted us out of a hallelujah, out of a horrible pit, out of a miry clay, set our feet upon a rock, established our goings, and put a song in our heart. Lord, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, for the remissions of sins, according to the riches of your grace. Lord, we thank you for the Holy Spirit, which has come to be our leader, come to be our guide, come to be our helper, come to be our strengthener, come to be our director. Hallelujah. We thank you for the Holy Spirit working in us right now. He's effectually working in all of them. He's effectually working in all of us that believe, Lord. We thank you, for it's not by power nor by might. It's by your Spirit, hey. It's by your Spirit, Lord. Ah, yeah, yeah. Oh, we can do all things through you that strengthens us. Greater are you that is in us than he that is in the world. We are complete in you. We are complete in you. We can do all things through Christ. We can do all things through you that strengthens us. Hey, we are not sufficient for ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of you. Hallelujah. All of our help coming from you. Yeah, you're the author, you're the finisher. You've begun the good work within us, and you who have begun the good work shall continue to perform it. Our eyes are upon you. Hey, we'll look to the hills from which cometh our help cometh from you, Lord. Lord, we thank you. We thank you tonight, Lord. Ha-ya-ya. We are dependent on you. We can do nothing without you. Yes, every good and every perfect gift cometh from you. You're the author, you're the finisher of our faith. You've begun the good work within us. And you who begun the good work shall continue to perform it. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. The name, the name, the name. Ha-ya-ha-ha. Yilimisharamahokoramaha. The name above every circumstance. Hey, every challenge, every conflict, every trial, everything hey, that comes in our direction. That name is a prevailing name. That name is a prevailing name. Hey, there's healing in the name. Deliverance in the name. Strength in the name. Peace in the name. Hi-ya-ya. Joy in the name. Completeness in the name. All that we need. All that we need is in the name. Lord, you've exalted that name and given us that name. Given us that name to use in prayer, whatever we ask in Jesus' name. The Father gives it. This is the confidence that we have in him. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Hey, knowing that he heareth us, then we know that we have petitions of the things, we have the petitions of the things that we've desired of you. Lord, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you that the name of Jesus has prevailed. It has prevailed in heaven. It has prevailed underneath the earth. It has prevailed here on earth. Hey, we thank you, Jesus, for the name of Jesus has been highly exalted. Ha, ya, ya. Hey, Satan must submit. No weapon formed against us will prosper because we have the name. We have authority in the name. We have power in the name. Hey, victory in the name. We give you praise, Lord. Hey, for the right to use the name. We can use it, Lord. Hey, when the enemy comes in, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we reign through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. We reign through the name. Hey, hallelujah. Satan is defeated. Hey, he's a defeated foe. Through the name. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, that victory is in the name tonight. Directions is in the name. Hey, ha, ha, ha. Peace and joy. Hey, righteousness, joy. Hiya. Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. It's in the name. Hiya, la, 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 la. We thank you tonight, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. Hey, hey, hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the peace of God that passes all understanding. Thank you for the joy that's unspeakable. Hey, you're the joy, huh, of my salvation. Lord, we thank you for the word of God. It has become the joy, the rejoicing of my heart. Lord, we thank you. We give you praise and the glory. For we delight in you. Yes, hallelujah. We rejoice evermore. How we love to magnify your name tonight. Father, we give you the praise. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. Yes, for the name. Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Well, we just thank God for his goodness. Amen. Surely goodness and mercy. Oh, yes. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Everybody just say, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Amen. Praise God for the victory. And I just want to give you a few notes for those that have kind of missed out on some of the sessions. I just want to give you a few notes and then we'll get into the lesson. We want to emphasize that the Lord's greatest attribute is showing favor. We call that benevolence is God's greatest attribute, showing favor, being inclined or disposed to showing favors. That is the greatest attribute of God. And when you begin to focus on the greatest attribute of God, that's the thing that gives people a greater level of confidence. It builds the faith, and it really causes people to rise up in expectation. Amen. Believing that God is a God that's disposed to show favor. Amen. And the scripture that we can probably memorize, probably say them all, but in fact, I've said them so much until I made some songs out of all of them. Amen. But there are certain scriptures that reflect God's gracious nature. Amen. We call this attribute of God, amen, is graciousness. Graciousness. He's gracious. That means he's inclined to show favor. And Psalms 145, verses 8 and 9 mentions, I read it, I keep reading, and we're going to just keep reading a whole lot of others, because once we can sing them and once we can reflect on them and they become a part of our system, then they become very glorious, and you really will begin to realize, amen, how these scriptures will really activate your faith and take it to a higher level. The Lord is gracious, Psalms 145, verses 8 and 9. He's gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. Amen. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all of his works. Amen. That scripture mentions graciousness, mentions compassion, it mentions God is slow to anger. It doesn't mean that God doesn't get angry. Amen. He gets angry, and sometimes the cup of wrath gets full, and God has to what? Take action, administer judgment. But judgment is not a thing that God is disposed to doing. Amen. The Bible calls it a strange act. That's Psalms, Isaiah 28:21, a strange act. In other words, God is very slow taking revenge on things that displeases him. He's very slow. Amen. And I guess you can appreciate people that are not so quick to judge you and to take action and to try to retaliate or get even with you. People that's tolerant with your faults. People that's willing to look beyond your faults and see your need. Amen. You can really appreciate people with those types of disposition. Amen. But sometimes with the least infraction of some rule or law or feeling or whatever, sometimes when people are crossed, they immediately rise up and try to strike back or take vengeance. But God is not like that. He wants to be like him. He wants to be slow to anger. So God is, judgment is a strange act, and God tolerates judgment. I mean, he tolerates evil until he just gets sick and tired. Or we can say it this way, until you can violate a law so long, amen, and the causeless shall not come. The curse causeless shall not come. So whenever you violate a law, sooner or later that law will catch up with you. For instance, like eating wrong, you violate that all the time. People go out to eat and you start shaking salt. Right? They don't taste nothing, they just start shaking salt. They violate the law. They're getting three or four, not like some people. But most times, it doesn't come against you right there, does it? You don't reap the results of breaking that law right then, but it's just a cumulative type thing, right? Then just keep what building up. Just get more and more saturated with acid and salt until it gets to a level where one day you might, amen, have a stroke or something. Amen. And that's not God doing it, is that right? As a result of some what? Law. Of course, God made all the laws, but most things happen as a result of violation of some law. Spiritual law, natural law, amen, most things happen. But there's a time that God does minister judgment directly. Amen. And I want you to the scripture that we gave you Sunday, get these things clearly in your mind. Turn to Romans. We just want to clear this up. We know that God is good. The strongest attribute of God is his love or his compassion. But there are other attributes. We just mentioned anger. We mentioned judgment. But these are not the primary characteristics of God's nature. They are things that God has to do in order to be a holy God, but basically these are things that God is very reluctant and very slow to do. Amen. Romans 2, let's just go back there. Just want to make sure that everybody's getting this. Romans 2:2, but we're sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. Thinkest thou this, O man, that judges them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Amen. The answer is no. Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness? Okay, that's a scripture which says the riches of his goodness and forbearance. That's characteristic of God. Forbearance, long-suffering. Not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Amen. So you can see that God's goodness and forbearance and long-suffering, these are attributes of God. Because God doesn't execute judgment speedily against an evil. But the reason why he prolongs that, he's trying to get you to come into harmony with his law, his word. Amen. So if you violate God's law in the area of nutrition, God will really send people by. Amen. Send somebody to tell you, honey, you don't need to start shaking salt before you taste your food. Amen. He'll send Brother Travis back, Brother Holden. And he'll send Brother Terrence back. Amen. And amen. And after we just ignore, the Bible says that when we ignore God's warning, then, the law of retribution just kind of automatically what catches up with you. Because when your body gets so saturated, it's going to react very negatively. Okay, so the goodness of God and the reason why God doesn't judge people when they are indeed are guilty of violations of his word is because he's trying to get their attention. He wants them to realize that they need to change their ways and come to him and be saved. He's not willing that any would perish. That's one thing about God. He doesn't want anybody to die and lose their soul and go to hell. So he puts up with people many years, and after they harden their neck, and sometimes people take God's goodness wrong. They say, well, God is, nothing has happened. I know I've been violating God's word. I know I ain't living like I should live, but ain't nothing happening. Things are going so well. I'm still prospering. I'm still feeling good. Ain't nothing bad happened to me. Amen. It hasn't affected my finances. Amen. It hasn't affected my son T. So they just conclude that God has overlooked us, he's not going to recompense them, and they many times will continue to persist in that sin. But the scripture says that, but after thy hardness and impenitent heart treasures up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. Although God might not judge it all here in this life, but a person can just continue to stack it up. And what that means, if God doesn't judge it, amen, that means that you're going to have to pay double in the life to come. So there will be different degrees of punishment, amen, in the life to come. Some people will be beaten with a few stripes, and some going to be beaten with many. Those that knew and didn't do it, going to be beaten with what? Few. Is that right? Those that should be beaten with what? Many. Amen. But there will be different degrees. People that haven't heard, amen, haven't been exposed to the gospel, haven't been exposed to things that we have been in America, amen, they will be judged by a less severe standard of judgment. I just wanted to make that clear, but that doesn't take away from the point that God is still gracious, and even him tolerating, putting up with sin, trying to get us to get on the right track, amen, that is a strong argument, amen, to show you that God is what a good God, and he's full of compassion, and he's slow to anger. Everybody can say amen to that. Say amen. Okay, now, the best illustrations that we can give you, if you want to search your Bible, you could just take these scriptures down. Nehemiah 9, verses 7 through 38. That's the history of God's mercies regarding the children of Israel. And you can't get it any clearer than that passage, because it tells about all of the things that the Israelites were subjected to, and all of the times that they turned against God, but God still was very faithful all through the wilderness experiences that they endured. God proved to be faithful on every hand. Amen. And many times they turned against Him, but God still was merciful. God delivered them, He rescued, He raised up deliverers. Amen. He worked miracles, rained down bread from heaven. Whenever they were sick, He sent His word through one of the prophets, and He brought healing. In fact, Israel experienced 450 years of healing just by the covenant that God made with them, amen, at the onset of their wilderness experience. He said, if you would diligently hearken unto me and keep my word and do all that I've said, amen, I will take sickness away from you, and I will be Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth thee. So God had established a covenant of healing with them, which lasted 400 years in succession. No doctors, no hospitals, no infirmaries, clinics, no medical assistant. Amen. I wish that level of faith in God was prevalent today. Amen. How many believe that God is the same yesterday, today, forever? There's no other historical record of God's mercies being any greater than that, except for one. That was in the first three centuries of the church, when all that the people of God had was the prayer of faith and the oil. Even that's all that they trusted. None of them, for three centuries, whenever they got sick, I mean the real church, amen, you never hear about them going to doctors during that period of time after the disciples, amen, had laid the foundation and they were thoroughly established in the Word of God. All that they trusted for their healing for about three centuries was the prayer of faith. That's James 5, 14 to 15. If any sick among you, let them call for the what? Elders of the church, and let them pray, amen, pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. Amen. That's all remedies. That's all the remedies that they had in the first three centuries. Amen. Because their level of faith was kind of different than it is today. Before it was watered down, and a lot of hypocrisy and error began to get mixed in with it. They had faith just to trust God and take God at His word. So they anointed people with oil, and they prayed the prayer of faith, and the prayer of faith worked every time. Amen. Because they were well established in that promise that was made to them. The prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall what? Raise them up. Amen. So just take these scriptures down. Nehemiah 9, verses 7 through 38. And you can take this down. Numbers 14, 11 through 19. That was Moses' plea for mercy. Moses knew, even when God got Numbers 14, verses 11 through 9. It's good sometimes just kind of read these, at, you know, read these stories out, because Moses pleaded for mercy because God was at the verge of what? Destroying Israel and wiping them off and raising up a nation that would actually be a better nation. And God said, Moses, I'll raise you up a new nation of people, and I just want to destroy them all. God must have gotten really, really angry. Anybody remember what God got so mad about? Amen. The thing that made God most angry was what? Idolatry. Yes, idolatry. Amen. That's the thing that makes women and men most that'll disturb them more than anything. Amen. When somebody is caught in what? Idolatry. I mean, adultery. Maybe I said adultery. Amen. Unfaithfulness. Unfaithfulness is something that is really, really sets people off. So it set God off. And at the verge of annihilation, God almost completely destroyed him. Amen. But Moses made a plea to God, and he based his plea on what? God's mercy. He said, Lord, you are merciful God. You are gracious God. Amen. Just look at all of the mercy that you've shown Israel all through the wilderness experience. Amen. If you would pull something like this, what in the world, all of these nations that have this great fear and respect for you, what would they think? They will say, God, you're not even able to take these people, amen, to that land that you had promised them. But when Moses made his plea for mercy, God's mercy, God said, well, okay, I'll do it one more time. Amen. So mercy, compassion is a very compelling appeal, amen, when you begin to approach God. Amen. All right, the second thing I want you to write down is the compound names of Jehovah. Those are names that disclose the benevolent and compassionate heart of God. Compound names of Jehovah. And we all familiar with these. The reason why these are so important, because these names cover every realm of man's needs. So God is not simply concerned about some of our needs, but the scripture says, my God shall supply what? All of my what? Need according to his what? Riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Amen. God promised to supply all of our need according to his riches and glory through who? Christ Jesus. Now that's the basis that God is able to dispense these favors into our lives. It's according to the riches of his glory through Christ. It's everything that we receive that's so good is based on the provisions that God has made for us through Christ. In other words, this was something that was agreed on before the foundation of the world, that Christ would become sin. God knew beforehand that man would be what? Victimized by Satan and be brought into what? Sin. And God made provision before there was a problem. He had the answer before there was a problem, right? Amen. Because that's the foreknowledge of God. And they made that agreement that when man would fall and succumb to Satan's temptation, that Jesus would become the mediator and the propitiation for man's sin. And for that reason, God still could bestow upon man the mercies, amen, when the conditions were met, amen, based on the provisions that God had made through Christ ahead of time. Amen. Amen. So Christ, Jesus is the center of everything that we have. Amen. Everything that we have, everything, every blessing, scripture says, every good and every perfect gift coming from what? From above. Amen. How many glad that Jesus became sin for us? Amen. So those compound names of Jehovah are designed to cover every realm of need that we will ever have, from the time that we come until the time that we leave. All right, that the compound names for Jesus, for the Jehovah, can be found in your book here. So you always can find something in some of these books. And that's prayer is what? A prayer of thanksgiving and praise. That's a prayer you need to pray on a consistent basis, because I try to incorporate all of these mercies so that you could actually begin to name and enumerate them on a daily basis. I try to incorporate and express it on, or articulate it in a prayer called a prayer of thanksgiving and what? Praise. We mentioned all about the Jehovah's and all of these mercies and blessings, and it just makes me real happy when I read over that prayer. Amen. Praise God. It makes me real happy. Amen. Praise God. All right. So I'm just trying to let you know where everything can be found, because a lot of this can be done in privacy and secret. And, amen. Boy, I like this so much, Brother Terrence, that I made me some songs on all of these scriptures. Oh, they sound good to me. Come on, that son. Y'all want me to say them to you? Cecile said no. Cecile said no. Amen. So y'all go by sound. Y'all go by voice. Y'all say amen. Yeah, and y'all don't consider the anointing that on something. Glory. Praise God. So you got to get used to, amen, going with the anointing rather than sound. Somebody that get up and sing, if they don't sound just right, amen. So why don't you sit down? Amen. I don't care how anointed it is. It's got to what, sound a certain way. Okay, the third area that we want you to build up, the reason why I'm doing this, it sounds so elementary, but this is the secret of prayer. You got to make prayer so exciting. You got to put elements in your prayer that make God as big and powerful and good and loving. Amen. You got to make him more super, super, super big, good. You got to make it singing, looking good. And the more you exalt him, the more you talk about him, the more you magnify him, whenever you begin to talk about these virtues that God is really, really, amen, what describes his attributes, when you begin to talk about that, that begins to build your faith more than you will imagine. Now, I'm just going to just read before I give you the third one, because the third one is going to be very powerful. F.F. Bosworth says that the most conspicuous, the most readily seen statement in the scripture about our Heavenly Father are the declarations concerning his love, his mercy, and his compassion. He said that these scriptures that we are talking about and focusing on, these are scriptures, the scriptures that are the most conspicuous. In other words, you can't miss it.
Sounded concerning that would so inspire faith as this one. I'm going to read that again. There's no note that can be sounded concerning the virtues of God that would so inspire faith as this one. In other words, there's no part of the scriptures that can inspire and motivate and move and push your faith to a level where it will become mountain top high. Amen. Nothing will do it like those scriptures that pertains to God's compassion, God's love, and God's mercy. Now that gave me an idea. You can learn from people that had seen millions and millions of people healed. He said, if you really want people healed, he said that you're going to have to focus on. This is what Jesus did when all of those people came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. What part of the scripture did Jesus focus on? He focused on what? Amen. His mercy, his love. And he gave illustrations of how that love was demonstrated, amen, in times past. Amen. Now, this is a good illustration. Remember the Gadarene demoniac. Anybody ever heard that before? When he came to Jesus, you know, he was very loony. And I never seen, I mean, that was the worst case I ever experienced. I mean, remember, let me see, Mark 5, I believe it is. That's about the worst case I saw, okay? This is Mark 5 and 2. When he was come out of the ship immediately, there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains.
because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him, and cried with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not." For he said unto him, "Come out of a man, thou unclean spirit." See, anybody else would not have received somebody that was in that condition. Somebody was all messed up full of demons. Amen. Rather than trying to minister to him, amen, they would probably have, condemned him or tried to dismiss him out of their presence. But Jesus said, "Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit." And he asked him, "What is thy name?" And he answered, said, "My name is Legion, for we are many." My name is Legion, for we are many. It seemed like there was at least 2,000 of them. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, "Send us into the swine, that we may enter into them." And forthwith Jesus gave them leave. See, that man's soul was more important than those 2,000 swine to Jesus. And the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. They were about 2,000 and were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled and told it in the city and in the country, and they went out to see what it was what that was done. They came to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And they that saw it told them how it befell to him that was possessed with the devil, and also concerning the swine. They began to pray him to depart out of their coast. And when he was coming to the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit, watch this, Jesus suffered him not, but saith unto him, "Go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and hath compassion on thee." See, Jesus sent this man away and told him to go home and tell all of your friends how, what great things, what I have done for thee. So anytime that they wanted faith built, they focus on compassion. Go home and tell your friends how, what great things God had done for them. Now, if you turn over to Matthew 15, you can see the results of his going home and telling his friends. Mark 15, 29 through 31, that is beautiful. Amen. This shows you that anytime, Matthew 15, 29 through 31, now this, if you had a Bible that connected all of the Gospels together, you could see that the results of that man being healed resulted into this man going back to his hometown, Decapolis, and he began to spread the word to everybody that he saw concerning the things that Jesus had done for them, for him. All right, and let's see the results of what happened. So anytime you want faith built, if you focus on the compassion side of God, that's the thing that really builds people's faith higher than any other part of the scripture. All right, verse 29, Matthew 15. Is that where I am? Matthew 15, 29. Jesus departed from thence and came nigh unto the Sea of Galilee, and went up into a mountain and sat down. And great multitude, this was the result of one man's testimony, and great multitudes came unto him, having with them those that were lame, blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, and cast them down at Jesus' feet, and he healed them, insomuch that the multitude wondered when they saw the dumb to speak, the maimed to behold, the lame to walk, the blind to see, and they glorified the God of Israel. Amen. That is marvelous because that man went out and began to tell everybody. Now suppose we would just go out and tell people the great things that God has done for us. Would that start a revival? Would that get people's faith moving? Amen. Praise God. See, this is the thing that God wants us to do. We are to what? Show forth His marvelous works. And that's the thing that really attracts people to what? Amen. To the kingdom of God when they can see God's love and God's power and God's goodness what magnified. Amen. I dare you, just begin to focus on God's love and compassion and just share that with people. All right. I just wanted to throw that in because that is one of these passages that shows that God's mercy is great. He's full of what? Tender mercies. Amen. Now, I gave you Nehemiah 9, 7-38, right? I gave you Numbers 14, 11-19. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
And the second area, maybe the third, compound names of Jehovah. That disclosed the benevolent and compassionate heart of God. And then the next thing I gave you was that particular passage concerning the Gadarene demoniac. That is one of the greatest demonstrations of the Lord's mercy and compassion. All right, then if you would read Psalms 23, that would be a passage that reflects God's mercy. Because the Lord our shepherd takes in all of the different realms that we mentioned about Jehovah. A shepherd has to take full responsibility for all of the need of the what? Sheep. And if you look down through Psalm 23, you can see that every area of the sheep's needs were actually what? Met by the shepherd. So that's shows you that God is, the Lord is our what? Shepherd. And we shall not what? Want. Amen. Is he a good shepherd?
Amen.
Okay, amen. Scripture says he laid down his life for the what? Sheep. Amen. So he was a good shepherd. So that reflects the Lord's mercy. Psalms 23. Psalms 103. Starts with, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. That whole chapter is a chapter that you can read and really begin to get inspired and motivated by the Lord's mercies. Amen. We want to inspire you to build yourself up in prayer because we want to take this charge that we are receiving from studying about the mercy and the compassion of the Lord and really begin to translate that into actually showing mercy ourselves. We can receive God's mercy, but God wants us to what? Take that mercy and what? Show mercy to others. How many can say amen?
Amen.
That's the motivation behind it all. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall what? Obtain mercy. So if you really want more mercy, amen, you what? You show more. Everybody, if you want a lot more mercy, amen, you what? You show more. Amen. It works every time. Amen. The more mercy you show, you show your loved ones, well, the more you get. Is that right? The more they what? Will reciprocate. All right. Now let's move further. These are, okay, now Job's affliction was another illustration that you want to write down. Job's affliction was a very good illustration of God showing mercy to an individual. And there's no way I can go over all of that, but I wish I had time to go over it, over all of the things that happened to Job and how God, amen, treated Job on the end. You can turn to James 5. I think everybody knows the story of Job.